Right now in history, major private space industry players like SpaceX are investing millions, even billions of dollars into projects aimed at permanently relocating humanity into space. It's a grand and wondrous dream, one that has rightly captured our species' imagination for thousands of years, propelling us towards exploration and the quest for other forms of life. All of this is magnificent and commendable, but if scientific curiosity is truly driving us, why don't we realize that right here, just a stone's throw away, on this very planet, there's an equally mysterious world to explore beyond the Earth's surface. What is that world? Well, it's the ocean depths. Isn't it strange? Continents are teeming with human beings, currently over 7 billion and rapidly increasing. Yet, even more surprisingly, despite all our technological prowess, humanity persists in crowding itself onto dry land, which constitutes just 29% of the planet's surface. The rest is dominated by seas and oceans, where the permanent human population is precisely zero. Why? How can this be? We have detailed maps with resolutions down to less than a meter for distant worlds like the Moon and Mars. Yet, all we know about the ocean depths is represented with a resolution in kilometers. Is that not surprising? Perhaps not when we consider that there have been 12 men who have walked on the moon, compared to just 3 who have reached the deepest point of our oceans, the Mariana Trench, at a depth of 1,100 meters. Of course, we can't use satellites to scan the seafloor because water is opaque to electromagnetic radiation. We need different, slower approaches like sonar. Still, it's a fact that even today, less than 5% of the oceans have been mapped with a resolution finer than 1,000 meters. But it's not just a matter of geology. We also know practically nothing about the creatures inhabiting these ocean depths. Biologists estimate that after 1,000 meters in depth, there may be at least 750,000 animal species yet to be discovered, many of them of considerable size. It's almost certain that many of these species will go extinct before they are ever discovered. Yet, undeterred, we persist in seeking life among the stars. This way, we can affirm with certainty that we have understood almost nothing about a world that, to stay grounded, provides at least half of the oxygen we breathe, mitigates the effects of climate change by removing over a third of the carbon dioxide we produce, provides food to at least a billion people, and allows for the cost-effective movement of 90% of the world's goods. And perhaps more than a scientific curiosity, it will be economic interests that drive nations to finally kickstart a systematic exploration of the ocean depths. The reason? Mineral resources. A partially initiated program, but only from the marine surface or in proximity to coastlines. The question we pose is whether all this will lead to the conception of permanent, habitable settlements. Let's try to understand it together. Alright, the ocean depths are certainly the closest alien environment to us, but they're also incredibly challenging to explore, primarily due to their vast expanse and depth. These abysses not only harbor billions of bizarre life forms, but can also be considered treasure troves of incredible mineral resources. It's wealth we've only begun to tap into. And even then, we've mostly confined ourselves to the sea floor within the continental shelf. Currently, mining operations occur in those marine areas where deposits are extensions of those on land, reachable from shore through tunnels. The extracted raw materials include coal, tin, various metallic deposits, and even diamonds. Salt, sulfur, and potassium are other resources deposited on the seafloor as a result of evaporation. Fluid reserves consist of trapped oil and natural gas beneath the ocean floor. Their extraction is now routine, reaching depths of up to 6,000 meters. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. It's only about 70 kilometers from the coast that the true ocean basins begin, where according to estimates, approximately 90% of the most precious minerals are found. This includes the famous manganese nodules, which has sparked a sort of gold rush, containing several metals such as manganese, iron, nickel, cobalt, copper, titanium, molybdenum, and most importantly, rare earth elements, minerals that have become crucial for controlling cell phone technology. Nodules have formed through the accretion of metals dissolved in seawater around the solid core, such as a piece of shell or a shark's tooth. Their average size ranges from 5 to 10 centimeters, and they are located at depths between 2,000 and 6,000 meters, deposited on the sea floor. However, there are currently no suitable technologies for their large-scale collection. Some countries like Japan and South Korea have created prototypes and conducted depth tests, but they have not yet developed a large-scale technology. The numerous difficulties mainly stem from the need to create tools that can withstand the enormous pressures of the ocean floor for extended periods without requiring constant maintenance. Everyone's currently focused on space, with more enthusiasm around the idea of terraforming Mars than doing something simpler, like building on the moon or creating an orbital city. But the oceans are much more accessible. We don't even have to leave our planet. Building in the sea would also help us prepare for life in space because we'd need to overcome similar technological challenges. In both cases, we would need to construct sealed, oxygenated habitats insulated from the external environment. One difference is that in space, extreme temperatures are a significant challenge, while in the ocean, the issue is the tremendous pressure of the water. Although the surface of Mars can reach 20 degrees Celsius at the equator during the summer, temperatures plummet to minus 75 degrees Celsius at night. The temperature of the ocean's surface waters, on the other hand, ranges from minus 3 degrees Celsius to 36 degrees, with an average of about 17, making it habitable only with a reliable heating system. Water pressure is certainly a concern, and it probably wouldn't be a great idea to build our underwater cities at a depth greater than 1,000 feet. At that depth, structures would already have to withstand a pressure of about 30 atmospheres. The enormous pressures and very low temperatures of the deep waters present open engineering challenges. It's worth noting that at 2,000 meters depth, there are about 200 atmospheres. Temperatures vary from 4 degrees Celsius at 1,000 meters depth and drop dramatically to a maximum of minus 40 degrees Celsius with increasing depth. However, this remains the only significant obstacle, and we have already sent crewed submersibles to depths exceeding 10,000 meters. An advanced underwater colony would only cost a fraction of what it would take to colonize Mars. In fact, there are already projects in the works. Polish architect Krzysztof Kotala has designed underwater urbanized structures that can aid in the development of deep-sea mining, ocean farming, underwater energy production, and other industries. These modular underwater structures would serve as bases from which people and machines could explore the underwater world and utilize ocean resources. The underwater urbanized structures include two main models, a fixed module and a mobile version. The fixed module has a hexagonal shape that can be anchored to the sea floor at depths of up to 100 meters. The mobile module will be diamond-shaped and designed to reach depths of up to 300 meters. Both types of modules would be coated with polygonal ceramic tiles to distribute water pressure at various angles, dissipating forces acting on the outer shell. Kotala's vision includes marine farms for fish, mollusks, and algae, as well as greenhouse algae cultivation, which would also generate oxygen as a byproduct. Industrial-scale ocean farming in the wild is the future of human nutrition, according to Kotala. Subsea mining would involve robots and other machines along with habitats and various structures for people to maintain these machines. Energy could be generated from nuclear power and a series of large, flexible, perforated mats stretched over areas with strong ocean currents. The mats would capture water movement through turbines and convert that movement into electricity. Much more complex and advanced is the Ocean Spiral Project, an underwater city proposed by Shimizu Corp, one of Japan's largest construction companies. Although conceptual, the project is designed for a deep ocean environment. an underwater plateau or continental rise where the water depth could reach 5,000 meters. The city would feature a 500-meter diameter sphere known as the Blue Garden, where the residents of the underwater city would live, and an industrial structure called the Earth Factory, which would be located on the seabed and used to develop deep-sea resources. A spiral tunnel structure known as the Infraspiral would connect the Blue Garden to the Earth Factory. Trains within the Infraspiral would transport people and essential supplies to the factory on the seabed and carry the factory's products to the surface. Resin cement could potentially be the primary construction material for the ocean spiral structures, and carbon fiber legs would anchor the city to the seafloor. While the top of the Blue Garden sphere would normally remain above the water, protected by a floating breakwater structure, the entire sphere can be submerged at a safe distance beneath the waves in case of extremely adverse surface weather conditions. Much of the energy required to maintain the massive structure would come from a small nuclear plant, but a green solution is also considered by harnessing geothermal energy at hydrothermal vents in volcanic areas. In these areas, water reaches temperatures around 400 degrees Celsius, while the surrounding water temperature is about 2 degrees Celsius. If the geothermal energy from these vents were harnessed, it could power the machines for mineral collection and send excess energy to the floating city. Developing machines capable of working at both high and low temperatures and high pressures is a significant engineering challenge that could be useful in space exploration. For example, such technology could be used to explore the Venusian surface, where there is a pressure of about 90 atmospheres, equivalent to a depth of 900 meters in the sea, with an average temperature of 470 degrees Celsius. Similarly, we could send probes capable of penetrating deep into the atmospheres of gas giants to better understand their internal dynamics and composition. Some of the technological challenges outlined above may seem impossible to overcome, but technological progress in these areas is rapid. Perhaps the possibility of building cities under the sea will become a reality, or perhaps, like other futuristic concepts, it will remain a suggestion. However, we must also consider the impact of human activity, both extractive and colonization. According to many scholars, intensive mining and direct habitation of the seabed could have devastating effects on marine habitats. There are valid concerns that intensive mining could irreparably alter not only the flora and fauna of the deep sea, but also the tectonic balance of the Earth's crust. What do you think? Would it really be worth it to take such a big risk?